so I can just, what can I do? Yeah. And I can see she's trying to work on it. Every constellation, she does some work, and she tries to heal, and she's trying to understand and build a bigger picture, and trying to move forward. And I can only honor that. Yeah? The worst is the kind of, before we were just stuck with it. We didn't understand it. It just came out, and we just said, you're nasty, or et cetera, et cetera. But now we can see, you know, two generations back at least, sometimes three generations back, the pictures of the problems and the money and the infidelity and all kinds of other things that were going on, and start to picture in communism and see how it all worked. And you just go, okay. So it allows you to process all these things so much more simply. But without that picture, you just say, you just be nasty. Yeah? You just don't care. You just, you know, yeah? So, the more we're aware, the more we get a picture. So one of the first things is to get rid of some of this anger and pain. So often there are different kinds of methods to try to get some of this pain out, the tears out, the anger out. And then it's easier to control these forces, these human natures. So there's lots of couple relationships, because fears about finances often is really hard to talk about. Fears about going out with friends or going abroad. You know, I know one couple they had. Now, every time he was going abroad, she made life hell for him for 3 days. And, you know, the children were there, and she made life hell, and he was worried, do I go? How are the children going to be treated if she's like this? You know, but if you trace it back, it's some probably in the war, you know, going back to the war, and probably the mother was taken away, and, you know, in the wartime, or the children were separated from the parents, and there's this story about separation, which is traumatic, and there's all this fear connected with it, and it's a, will he ever come back again, and, you know, et cetera, et cetera. And it's just a story inside the soul, which is not necessarily true, but it's amplified by this history. So the more you pick up that, the more you understand that this is happening, then you can either talk about it more, or promise to contact more often, or you know, just understand it better. So, late is often one of those sexual fears. There's also sexual abuse or these kind of things going on. Cleanliness, education is kind of a big thing, hobbies. His response to her stress. Anything else you find, you know, yeah, fallen natures might something come out. Anyway, okay, there's all kinds of books, Homecoming, Self-Esteem, Self-Compassion, Gifts of Imperfection. Perfection. Do you know Brené Brown? Have you ever heard of her? Mm-hmm. No, she's kind of a person who studied a lot about shame. And she found out there are kind of two kinds of people, and there are those who are frightened of trust and can't enter into relationships, and those who are more, she called them wholehearted people, that can enter into relationships because they know that even if they get hurt, they can pick themselves up. But if people can't enter into relationships fully, it's often the reason is because they feel if they get hurt, they won't be able to get out of it. They're frightened that they don't have the inner resources. So she wrote this book about the gifts of imperfection. And she does a lot of work with women who are perfectionists. A lot of women in the world today are very perfectionists. My children have to be perfect. They have to be doing perfect things. My house has to be perfect. Everything has to be perfect. And these women are driving everybody crazy with their, and try to let it go. You're worthy as you are, and all kinds of things. So there's all kinds of different things going on. Then they have different books, and people heal with different books. You know, some people you give one book to, this is rubbish. And we've, you know, I've read certain books and I'm like, this is rubbish. And I'm like, go away. You know, and I'm like, wow, this is the cosmos and everything's working here for me. And we found family constellation worked for us. But somebody else said, it doesn't work for me. And I gave them the healing code. And he had terrible thyroid problems and his hair was falling out and everything else. And he started practicing the healing code. And within a few months, he was completely, his body was recovering, and he'd had it for years, this issue, you know. So, but it was, the healing code is very much about appreciation. Really getting more appreciative and getting back into that balance of what appreciation can do. So, but people have different emotional freedom techniques and calming themselves down by tapping themselves, so self-management, you know. Of course, you can do all kinds of things. You can make conditions. Now you can say, what's a condition? In this constant, in this thing, what is this condition to try and heal this, you know? So a condition, so as I said, I found I could move away from a lot of, to start to move away by going out every day and praying in gratitude for other people, to appreciate the leader better. My balance of criticism partly was because I couldn't see his good point. Never could see his good point. So I had to appreciate and gratitude and strengthen that so that any attack that I felt from my fallen nature was easier to deal with. Yeah? So we can strengthen the good parts. If we can sense the loss that we feel, we had in the last family constellations, I could really, really sense all the lost love. I never received from my grandfather, who died in the Second World War, the lost love from my father, who, because he was beaten up by his father, you know, the loss of all that love, to feel, to sense it, and just to cry and just say, I'm sorry, God, we've lost all this love. And to kind of let that be a part of your getting out of pain, the lost love. You know. How to get that out? We've lost so much. One Europe, two wars. We've lost so much. How all that money and all those people and all that love and all the families and all the pain. So much, we do not realize how much we love. And how God saw his children hurting each other. And how we all have been hurt by that. We, all of us, have a worse life today because of that. And a lot of the struggles in couples today is to do with the Second World War and the First World War. And how they can process that. Just a lot of fear and a lot of pain and a lot of sense of separation. Boys and without fathers, and kind of thing. And how we cry that out and heal ourselves.
So you place yourself in a Cain and Abel relationship.
So you say, anybody in your life, you say, I want you to be my Abel. And God will work. Over the next few weeks, he will do something to make you so upset. And trigger something in you which you really didn't want, you know? And you might have had a happy relationship for years, but if you say, please be my Abel, you know, then for sure something will happen, you know? And then you will have to say, this has triggered something in me, a resonance has happened, revealed something that I need to work on. This is very good, you know?
Okay.
So a church leader, we often get this really, really mixed up. A church leader is a church leader. They're not able. They're a church leader. And their job is to strengthen the goodness in the community. That's their job. To build a community with the five types of love in it, protection, community, sensible processing and helping people develop and grow and nurture and some fun time together and to work together as a team and to help this, all these God's love come into the community. That's their job. But if I choose personally, because only I can remove my fallen nature, God, if you're my church, I can say, God, I want to take you as my Abel. I want my this church to be, to represent Abel to me. And for sure, the next few weeks, they will do something for us to bring out your Canaan. So you can start working on it. And then you have more control, because you promised. But church leader is church leader. It's meant to build a healthy community. That's their job. Yeah? And we're meant to work to help them build that community. That is
it's completely different. So we have this, this kind of thing.
This self-control, self-dominion. I feel so angry. Why did she do that stupid thing? I feel just so disrespected. It's pain, anger. And this ability, on the other hand, to say, it's okay, I am a child of God. I have the wisdom and the knowledge necessary to solve this in a healthy way. And this is the goal.
Okay. So here we have a partner who's
leaving messes all over the house. Okay, so I'm the messy one. I leave my sock here, my clothes here. In the kitchen, I just leave things out all the time. I go to the fridge, make a sandwich, leave it out. I dump my stuff all over the living room. No, he's laughing. Okay, so what can my, you know...
And why are you taking me as an example?
You know, now of course this can either be a weakness and it can be discussed, you know. Maybe we need to put a laundry basket in the bedroom. Maybe we need a cleaning time on Saturday morning. Yeah, maybe, yeah. I'll clean the kitchen for you if you clean the bathroom. There's all kinds of rational give and take and sharing and sensible solutions and, you know, which a healthy human being can use. Yeah? Okay? So, yeah? So, I'm sorry, I asked the question. There's all kinds of sensible things. But if the person just has this lack of desire to grow, you know, then how do you deal with that? And it's complicated. But the worst thing is to respond with the fallen nature of your own. This just doesn't help anything. Yeah? So you might, if they refuse to pick up their clothes from the floor, you just say, okay, if they're not in the laundry basket, I'm not washing. That's it. Yeah? Or if he brings home stuff and dumps in the sitting room, I'm not picking it up. I just watch it grow. This is not my job. Yeah, I'm not participating in this game. I refuse to participate in it. I will love my husband, but I'm not going to get involved in his habits. I'm not going to get upset by it. I'm just going to make him realize the consequences. So when he says, I've run out of underpants, I have nowhere else to put the stuff. You know, the kitchen counter becomes completely trapped. You know, or there's no, you know, just whatever. Yeah, but how do you say, I'm not going to get involved in this game? Let the person realize the consequences. Because when you have alcoholism, for example, to help a person realize the consequences of it. That's part of the 12-step program of healing, to realize their own consequences, or gambling, or things like this. How do you help a person become aware and not try to get upset? But just, how do you help? Anyway, there's a lot to talk about, but, yeah. Okay. We have an exercise, which is really useful. I found it really useful in quite a lot of couples that I work with. It's an exercise which basically says, say for example, you come home late, okay? And you know, say I come home late, my wife gets upset, okay? Gets overly upset. So you sit down calmly, and you just simply go through the exercise. So let me go and get it for you. Can you get, what is it? No. It should be in a plastic folder. Oh, the third one back. Not that one, the fourth one back. That one.
That one.
Yeah, 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 yeah. Okay? Okay. So this is helpful for a friend or a child or anybody. It's just to help you understand what's really happening. And a useful thing. I got this wonderful book. There's some really wonderful books today. There's one by a girl, an English woman called Susan Johnson. And she's written these wonderful books about couples talking to about their fault, about their brokenness. And she gives lots of exercises you can do. And anyway, so basically this is a question. So for example, you write here, this is the issue. You write in the issue. And then say, you know, you're asking your wife, but she gets upset when you come home late. And you ask her, this one here, this is the dark sentence here, okay? Okay, so the issue is, when I come home late, you get upset, overly upset, okay? So if you think about one of the most vulnerable feelings connected with what happens when I come home late, yeah? What is the feeling you feel? What's the feeling you feel overwhelmed by? Do you feel lonely? Worthless? Unimportant? Helpless? Fearful? Hurt? Hopeless? Threatened? Rejected? Ignored? Inadequate? Abused? Unwanted? Embarrassed? Ashamed? Disappointed? Let down? Humiliated? So try to catch that emotion. What is this emotion that has stored away this feeling of loneliness or feeling of worthlessness or feeling that is coming up? What is this story? Hi, Karen. Oh, poor Karen. So tired. Okay. So, yeah. So you might say, what might you say? If he comes home late, what might be the emotion? And you get upset, what might be the emotion?
Fear.
Okay, good. So you would put down fear, okay? And then he would ask you the next question. At some point in your life, maybe you felt fear at other points in your life. Has ever in your life been experienced where you felt fear in your childhood? Were there some moments when you had fear?
Being left alone.
Left alone in the mountains. Okay, so when you were left alone in the mountains.
Abandoned.
Sorry.
Wow. Do you understand?
Yeah.
This is the right word.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Okay.
Shock.
Ooh. Okay. Yeah. So then you would talk, I don't want to do it here, but then you would talk about, this. You would listen to your story about being abandoned in the mountains. And maybe you might cry.
Abandoned in the mountains.
Abandoned.
Yeah.
To be abandoned, not necessarily in the mountains.
Just abandoned somewhere.
Yeah, everywhere.
Okay, but have you in your life ever felt fear? You know, had experience where you felt a lot of fear? Yeah. So you talk about that moment. Because that fear is trapped, maybe. And this is resonant, this extended, what you're asking now is just touching, you know, resonating, reliving. So the more he can understand where this fear comes from, the more he can look at it, and you can look at it as a couple, the more compassion you can have, the more understanding of each other. And then he might ask you the next thing, well, you know, is there any other time you felt fear? And really try to understand your history of fear. So he becomes more aware, oh, if I'm late, there's all this fear and I might be triggering. And this, maybe if you let out some of that fear and tears and let go of some of that, maybe you have more control over that fear, and maybe he can have more compassion. So instead of just getting home and having a long argument, you know, because you're terrified, he would, you know, he gets home and you can, okay, I said, sorry, I triggered your fear again, and I'm really apologize, I treated you better. So this becomes a better understanding of the history of emotional pain. And the more you understand each other's history, the better you can process it. You catch that?
Yes, sir.
Yeah? Can I understand that point? Sorry, I'm sorry it's so long, so much today. But this is one method I've used quite effectively on a lot of couples to try to help them understand how to process each other's emotional history better. Because if you don't understand where it's coming from, the person can just look like somebody you really don't know or you don't want to know. Yeah? Okay? And at the end, if a friend came to you and said, let's say they had the same challenge, so a friend came to you ever and said, oh my gosh, when my husband late, I kind of get all frightened and panicky, and I just kind of blow up at him, etc., etc., what advice would you give? Yeah? What advice would you give her from a healthy, you know, healthy responses. We have the negative ones here, sorry, but we should have the healthy ones here. What response would you give? How would you say, oh, maybe you can fix it this way, maybe you can solve it that way? So try to look for better solutions to the problem, yeah? So if you're going to be late, can you make sure you find them more, okay, et cetera, et cetera. Yeah? So, yeah, makes sense. Yeah. But we all come with luggage. It's kind of heavy. And some of us more than others. And the more we're aware of it and say it is part of it, and accept it and say, okay, it's part of our families and our histories, and the more we understand it, the more we can have compassion for it, the more we can let it be, and in our, and just say, It's just one of those things. But we do not have to be controlled and dominated by it. So then the more we can, you know, let the energy disappear from our family tree. And hopefully our children are healthier. You know. Does that kind of make sense? This kind of root of fallen natures and how we make sense to you.
Well, I just make a comment that
please.
You know, we live in a very special time because whether we realize it or not, the two worlds coming together and our barriers breaking down.
That
the father says that blessing is not a marriage happily ever after, it's about restoration. So, actually, if I look at my own situation, and, you know, with our children, things come out. Where did that come from? I don't feel that we are directly responsible for what is going on.
Yeah.
I remember Father saying that around about 12 years of age, children's spiritual senses open up. You know, like, up to a certain age, they're very much protected spiritually. But when they reach a certain age, they're kind of open, and then things from ancestry, spiritual influence them. But the good thing is that they come out because they need to be solved.
Mm.
Yeah?
For sure.
So that in all these different books,
mm,
it's because the time has come to,
yeah,
solve them.
Yeah.
So, and also because we're blessed with this,
yeah,
we get quite a lot of stuff.
We get a lot of stuff.
Yeah,
sure.
Because, you know.
Because for us it's important.
Yes, also because we're blessed families, that,
yeah,
the ancestors and spirit, well, they come and think, yeah, clearly, let's give them a hard time, or let's come down and give the problem so they can solve them, because, you know, they've got the merit of true parents and blessed families and all this. And so, on the one hand, it looks like really, wow, such a heavy load.
Mm.
On the other hand, that heavy load means it's coming out, and it needs to be resolved.
Yeah.
And these techniques, all these different techniques, it's like a blessing, because there's a way.
Yeah, way to look, yeah, yeah.
So rather than being depressed and feeling, why are things going wrong?
Yeah.
And feeling a victim.
Yeah.
You'd be more say, well, it's a sign that I have to do something. There's some learning point. There's something I need to do. Like you said earlier, rather than feeling, oh, woe is me.
Mm.
Why am I suffering so much? Or why are things not the ideal as they're supposed to be? But actually, it means there's something we need to learn and need to change.
Mm. Yeah, absolutely. I completely agree. The one thing I would disagree with, it's just a 12-year-old bit. You know, we know so much about epigenetic code now. Do you know about the epigenetic code? We have DNA, and the DNA is there, which is a strand, long strand. But we also have another code. It's called the epigenetic code. It's really interesting. And basically, it carries the history of the emotional trauma of the family, or the emotional history of the family. And what it does is, the way it affects, is basically, in a certain sense, what we understand, from what I understand, is that, you know, you have this lovely egg and the sperm's inside and they're trying to grow. And this history of the environment, of family and everything else, is kind of covering this, and it's allowing certain chemicals in, and it's, you know, not allowing other chemicals in. So certain things, it allows certain things to develop within the child, and certain things less developed or more developed. So when you have a history of like anger or abuse or suffering or whatever in your family, then this emotion, this epigenetic code, will tell the DNA, you have to become strong physically fit, and you have to put more energy into muscle development and kind of the ability to be more aggressive, rather than developing your brain or whatever else, the capacity for intelligence or whatever else, because it's a crazy world out there, because it's more aggressive.
What did you call that?
Epigenetic code.
You write it on the
book? Yeah.
Hands on top.
The old fashioned white book.
The old fashioned.
Yeah.
Okay.
Okay.
Epigenetic. Okay. Yeah. So there's a wonderful YouTube video, like, what's his name, Bradley or something? Something. This is a lovely, like, 1.5-hour talk by him. And he explains how he understands that you have this code. And it allows things to come into the baby developing, and it doesn't allow other things. And so the brain in the womb is somehow is very affected in the body development is by the environmental history of emotional history. Because the DNA itself is kind of like a code, but it doesn't. Your body has to respond to the environmental factors. If you're going through a much more difficult time in human history, the body has to kind of adapt to that. The children have to come out in a different way, with different history, more aggressive or less aggressive or whatever, depending on how it's out there. So this epigenetic is pretty interesting, isn't it? And this carries, like, I would say it might carry the history of fallen traumas or the pain of history, and it just gets translated into the way we relate and everything else, and how we heal back and overcome that by trusting the Lord more, by being more grateful, by whatever it is, and try to. But it's yeah, okay. So we do see children when they come at the age of two. Many already have inherited what I would call the finished goodness, but many have inherited fallen natures, and you can see this already in them. And the process, the thinking process. I taught culture for like 8 years, and so I kind of got really interested in the Finnish programming. We have a program that goes for Finnish culture, and some of it's really healthy, but some of it is very, very hurtful. And they've already inherited that. You can see that in the way they're hanging, they relate and build, and trying to help them heal that. So already at two, we see this in one. Many times you can, you know, in that emotional connection with the mother, there's a lot of stuff going on, you know. And can I welcome the child into the world? Can the child feel trust and respect and bonding? Or is there a lot of anger? And what are you doing? I never wanted a son. I never wanted a daughter.
But that means intercultural marriages is very aggressive.
From a cultural viewpoint, it's very healthy, yeah. For sure. Yeah, but it can also be 10 kind of, but it, so you see on the curve of cultural marriages, you can either, if you do it right, if you work harder at them, because you have to work harder, then your children can get the benefits of both lineages. But you can also get it terribly wrong because you just misunderstand each other. So you can make it even worse. So if you're not working on your marriage, your intercultural marriage, you're just, it's really hard for the children to get the blessings from. And you have to work at it. You have to spend more time on it. Appreciate it. And you can never, you know, if you can't appreciate your partner's culture, if you, for example, say he comes from England, if you can't respect it and value it, this is really, really a pain, because the children can't inherit their father's, you know, the mother can interfere or the father can interfere, etc., etc. It's very complicated. Now you realise.
Yeah. There's another aspect of this, because what you're saying is that's within the genes or within whatever the. But the other aspect is the spiritual influence.
Of course.
You've heard of a book called Remarkable Healings by Dr. Lodi. So I have to just briefly say this.
Yeah.
This doctor, she's trained in different therapies, but the one that she's found 90% successful, remarkably successful. Mm-hmm. She puts patients under hypnosis, and we should talk about past life regression, but actually what comes are these spirits, and they start to speak.
Good.
They are the source of the emotional, psychological, physical problem, and they tell their story, and they are released, and these angels come and take them away. There are also evil spirits, like inside a person's head, who's causing headaches, who are there deliberately to cause problems. So this kind of, you could say, the spiritual world, you know, in the principle it talks about how evil spirits come because they want to take revenge, and they want to cause problems.
Absolutely. They have a common base. They need a common base to kind of connect to. So if you do have things, it would be so easy to multiply, for example. Well, you know. And I agree. I mean, I once read a book about this woman, and she does this therapy, Zumala, and she found that a lot of people went to hospital. After an operation, they inherited, you know, something like an eating disorder or a...
In hospital.
Yeah, well, after a hospital operation, they came back and they were given something called alcoholism, et cetera, et cetera. And then she had to kind of find out what the spirit had entered her into, which a person would try to let it out and release it. Yeah. And I had experience like that. I was in England 20 years ago. I went to hospital for my appendix. I came back home, and I could not close my eyes without total fear. I was so frightened. I had all these monsters just running around my room.
Oh, it was horrible. I spent like 3 days. I didn't want to close my eyes. I couldn't go to sleep. I was so frightened. Every time I closed my eyes, it was this horrible scene. I couldn't see beautiful sunsets that I usually can see or lovely nature. I just saw a monster after my operation. It was horrible. Mm-hmm. And I couldn't get much sleep and everything. So I went off to Korea and I did 40 days. And I said, I've got to get rid of this stuff. So every meditation seminar, this thing, I took 1 cubic centimeter of my brain, and every breath I breathed in, I sliced off like a very, 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 very fine piece of this spiritual garbage. And as I breathed in, I put it on that breath and breathed it out. And over the course of 40 days, I went through the whole of my brain. Every day focusing on every session. And the really behind the eyes was like, wow, trying to get a cubic millimeter took a whole session, you know, it's like, etc., etc. And then on day 37, in the middle of one of these sessions, you know, these sessions, I was there and then in walked 2 people in gowns. And my brain felt like the inside of a lovely white, windmill? It's converted, the top of it has been converted, it's all white, and you can see beautiful views out of the trees and the blossom and things like this, and the little birds and the sun shining in, it's all white and it's beautiful. And I had this picture of my brain looking like this, so beautiful. And in they walked, one lovely 2 white robes, and they had and one mother had a feather duster. And she said, "You missed it. You missed a bit." She dusted away, you know, like, I can do that bit, And I felt after, you know, that, I could close my eyes and finally be at peace with the world. And I had a wonderful, very, very liberated. But I gave my testimony, and so many people came up to the airport. Quite a few people said, "I struggle with the same issue."
So what happens at the hospital?
I don't know. I don't know why I came back with this horrible, pictures.
Because Dr. Lodi says that when people have operations, they become their aura, which is their protection of the spirit, becomes weakened and holds that the spirits will come into.
I can't say that that's what really happened, but this was my story, and all I know is I couldn't sleep, but I was terrified of closing my eyes. And I was terrified of thinking too deeply about anything for a long time until I went off to this.
Yeah, a question about the epigenetic code.
Yeah.
If there's no fallen world, what's the purpose of the... why did...
Well, the epigenetic code is there to help the baby understand what it needs to develop. And in a healthy world, it will develop healthy things. Yeah? So the DNA by itself is not enough. But the DNA is... It's like you have to... You have to have something... You could imagine God saying, your children have to be able to adapt the different environmental factors that are available. Yeah, I can appreciate that, I can say it's there. You can get a study of what you can be able to do. So any other questions? But we've got to 6 o'clock.
Who did you say the author was of this epigenetics?
I can't remember. It's just on YouTube.
Loads of books.
Yeah. But if you go on YouTube, there's some really good talks. As I said, there's this wonderful. What if you do that?
Let's see if I can find it.
But I'd have to get it all. Can I have any questions?
But I don't know if you can do them however long. If you think you are, you can have one or two more. But I have something called the Principles of Peace Building here, which I use, especially with my children, to discuss difficult issues. Yeah? So I found it really helpful. to go through these questions and to really listen to them, to really, really try to listen as best as possible. So, you know.
This is good stuff.
Yeah. It's, so this is a lovely family display. So we'll get a big piece of paper out or a big whiteboard. Just kind of write it all down and make it, you know, like clear. But just to sit down with my children. Oh. If you want to talk with a friend, that's something we have a hard time. I don't see you every
other time.
Good. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Yes.
Okay. So I hope somehow this is somehow giving you a way to look at the principle in a new way for growth, personal growth, self-management. But I understand it's an awful lot. I mean, it takes me a lot of time to develop any one of these. Just learning to forgive in 10 different ways took, you know, quite a while. And to realize that this one isn't going to be working, that one's not working, that one's not working, but there must be another one. Or how do I find something to appreciate in my partner this morning? Or, you know, how do I get that going? As I said, you know, just trying to be a better teamwork player, you know, this 3-minute thing, you know, was really useful as a habit forming thing. Just saying, I took some of that practices as kind of condition, 3 minutes to make the bed, 3 minutes to clean up the screen, 3 minutes to lay the table, 3 minutes to make a cup of tea, and practice as a condition. And then I kept some of them on after I got conditioned. That became part of me that I can do this. Yeah. So it was a condition, you know, to say there must be something more I can help to do. Just taking the time to say, oh, there's a problem. Okay, I'm going to make a condition of 5 positives to overcome this negative. You know, was a condition. You know, this is what I got to do. It's just to learn the habit and practice it better. So, whenever in blame, to try to sit down and catch that blame sentence and rewrite it and try to find words. It's taken years, you know, to kind of catch these things. It's not easy, you know, it doesn't come automatically. But if you, the more I develop this, the more I go, oh, this I can love my wife more each day. I can feel more connected to her and we have longer periods of joy and happiness together. And I really appreciate that. And that's what I feel good about, yeah. Some things I may never develop in my life, like the ability to sit down and talk with her about something might never happen. We might go through life, but that's good enough, you know. But so maybe my children will have to solve that and make sure children will need to remove some of the other stuff which is causing the tension, the fear, the anger, the frustration. Because it's impossible to talk about some of these things. Because it's so close to so many difficult pain and, you know, so many problems in the past. I mean, my poor wife, she grew up in complete poverty, you know, very difficult. You know, just get a new set of clothes was a major investment in the family. 2 5 people in 2 rooms and outside toilet and a You know what I mean? This is complicated, cold. And how to overcome the shame of that, you know, being by a friend, or the fear of not having enough money, or all these things inherited, you know, so much stuff. It's hard to overcome everything. One generation or two. But if we can loosen some of those bonds and work on that, then. So I just really appreciate your attempt to come today and to be here as much as you could be. And I know it's really hot and I talked too long and all kinds of other things. But I hope I can give you something to go away and grow with. If you can do that, you can say, yes, I can do that. This, I can do this one thing better for the next 2 months. This is all I want from this, from you.
But you'd like to come back.
I'm happy to come back. I've got so many other things to talk about. I've got mine and all these lectures piling up on my laptop. But, I'm happy to come back, yeah? But but I just want you to go away with a thought of growth. Because otherwise, what's the point of today? What's the point?
What did you say?
With the thought, I'm going to grow something.
Uh-huh.
I believe so.
Yeah.
I'm sorry I missed some part of your...
Yeah, yeah.
But now my friend called me from the States.
Yeah.
And he has been dead. He died.
Oh, sorry.
For five hours, but the doctor revived him.
Oh, so no.
He's back. So I have to listen to him now,
yeah,
because
yeah.
Now he comes back to Sweden.
Okay. Mm-hmm.
He's owner of Max Corporation.
Okay.
And when he spoke to me, I could not say. So I said to him, instead of being an atheist that you were before, maybe you're not agnostic.
Mm-hmm.
Maybe there is a. Yeah.
Why was he there?
Well, he lives in the winter time in Florida. And then he lives here in Stockholm.
Have you all, I want you all to at least think, even not write it down better, but what are you going to do differently when you get home?
What
are you going to do differently when you get home? What are you going to try and learn? Or what are you going to do differently? What do you realize? I want you to go away with a commitment to just be a different person. Otherwise, you'll get home and you'll get caught up with everything and it will just zoom. But I want a commitment, at least one thing that you say, I'm going to do differently in my life because of this, or I want to learn how to do this better. Commitment. Can anybody write it down before you walk out the door? After I talked for almost 8 hours and you cannot walk away and develop something, I will never, ever, ever come back.
Oh my God.
What is the point of this? What is the reason for this?
I'm writing as we speak.
One thing, just one.
No, you want us to give it to you?
No. I want you to make it. Wait, if you want to write your feedback form, I should just put that. Yeah? I should have put that down on the feedback form, the one thing that I'm going to change. One thing you're going to do better.
Something very practical.
Yes, something practical.
So when I come back and say, clean.
Listen to my wife.
Huh? Listen to your wife.
Okay. Yes. Just clear in my mind. I have a clear now. It's clear in my mind.
Good.
I know exactly what I'm doing.
Okay.
You can send me afterwards.
Don't tell me.
Well, you will see the change.
Hopefully.
So that I can support you.
Okay. Change is very complicated, you know?
Come on.
It's a very complicated thing.
Ooh.
We
shall write it down.
Yes.
You have to write it down, even if you don't tell you. You are not allowed to leave here until you've written it down, the one thing you're going to do.
I wrote my three.
Three.
Don't
overdo it, please. Yeah, thank you very much. Now, I'm so glad you came.
He's coming back tomorrow.
Oh, yes, the sun is early. Yeah. Tomorrow morning, we're going to be talking about the principles of creation.